is Five on Your Side.
Good evening. We begin tonight with a story of strength and recovery. A 7-year-old who was caught in the middle of a quadruple shooting has been released from the hospital and is back home with her family. Five on Your Side's Rachel Menatoff is live in our newsroom with a look at her story.
You may remember back in June, 4 people were shot in the Walnut East neighborhood. While 3 of those people didn't survive, the 4th, 7-year-old Denaya Irving, has overcome leaps and bounds. This afternoon, we had a chance to meet Denaya, her 2 sisters, Diera and Daria, and her grandmother, Lawanda, who are always by her side. Denaya is back in school. She's in 2nd grade, and right now she's balancing her schoolwork with physical, occupational, and speech therapy Monday through Friday. Denaya is the only one who survived. She lost both her mom, Jessica Garth, and her dad, Derek Irving.
God has allowed her to come through, and so we become the family for them to support them and see them through the storm.
Coming up tonight at 10, we'll show you how the community has wrapped its arms around this family and the generous donations it's made to support Denaya's recovery. Mike.
Rachel, thanks. New at 5, homicide detectives are investigating a shooting that took place in broad daylight this afternoon. It happened around 1:30 at West Florissant and Thrush in North St. Louis. A man who was shot several times in the chest was rushed to the hospital with very critical injuries. No word at this hour on his condition. Police are investigating. We now know the name of a man who was killed in St. Louis County on Friday. It happened just after 11 p.m. on Forest Hill Drive. Police say 54-year-old Stanley Taylor was found inside a home with multiple gunshot wounds. The incident is under investigation by the St. Louis County Police Department Bureau of Crimes Against Persons. If you have any information, you're asked to call Crime Stoppers at 1-866-371-TIPS. It's been almost a month since a judge found former St. Louis police officer Jason Stockley not guilty in the murder of Anthony Lamar Smith. Protests have continued ever since. Most have been nonviolent, but a few turned chaotic with mass arrests. Five on Your Side's Ray Strickland went to the Central West End, where the recovery from some damage continues, and Ray is live downtown.
And Mike, the Central West End was the first neighborhood that had businesses damaged after a judge found Jason Stockley not guilty. And almost a month later, some people say it's finally starting to feel normal again.
Boards still remain on several businesses in the Central West End weeks after a judge found Jason Stockley not guilty in the murder of Anthony Lamar Smith.
2-3 weeks now since the first night, things have pretty much returned to normal.
But days after the protests, David Harper says that wasn't the case.
But the first few days, I think people were kind of cautious, you know, kind of edgy a little bit. You could kind of feel it.
Curtis Hill has been coming to the Golden Grocer for decades. It was one of many businesses that had its windows damaged.
When I came through and saw it, I said, oh no, not here.
Since then, he says he feels the neighborhood is getting back to normal, but he says it did take some time.
This is the hub of the city. This is the one place where people can connect. And so it was kind of scary for a few days.
Owner of Golden Grocer John Lorico wasn't at his store the night of the protests. The day after, he showed up with people willing to help him rebuild, and his storefront windows that were once busted became a symbol of unity.
We've taken, you know, a damaging situation and turned it into a positive situation.
Harper says the city of St. Louis is now under a microscope and with the spotlight, an opportunity to make things better.
Whether we choose to do it or not is a whole nother question. But we're not going to solve it in one day or 1 week or 1 year.
And it is unclear how much business was affected in the Central West End after the protests weeks ago. But one business did tell me that yesterday was their best night of business since the protests. Live downtown, I'm Ray Strickland, Five on Your Side.
St. Louis police are investigating how a man tasered yesterday by an officer later died. The man allegedly forced his way into a Dogtown neighborhood restaurant and bar, then threatened the employees with a knife. Today, those employees are trying to move on from the terrifying experience.
It's a typical Sunday at the Tam Avenue Grill. The drinks are flowing, and customers are lining up for burgers.
I like it that it's local, and the food is fantastic.
It's just a good place to hang out on a beautiful day and enjoy the sun.
Today's atmosphere is a far cry from yesterday morning when the bar and grill closed following what an owner called total chaos.
I took a call from my kitchen manager, who was extremely frantic and panicked, telling me that there was a gentleman who had broken into the restaurant and was wielding a 10-inch butcher knife, threatening to kill the employees.
St. Louis police said in an email, responding officers told the man multiple times to drop the knife.
Asking the gentleman to set the knife down, put the knife down, which he did not do, he did not comply, they obviously tased him.
The man stopped breathing and later died.
Our thoughts are with the family of the gentleman that was involved.
No employees were hurt, but the experience was upsetting for everyone at the bar.
I mean, it's tough, you know. We're like family here, you know. Everybody's doing, you know, surprisingly great and just ready to get back to normal business.
The team at Tam Avenue says they got a lot of help and support yesterday from surrounding businesses. And it's good to see customers come in to help take their minds off yesterday's emotional roller coaster.
Dogtown is a small neighborhood. You know, everybody's very proud to live here, and the support was huge.
So far, St. Louis police have not released the name of the man who died. The department's force investigative unit is now handling that case. Someone had to be airlifted from this scene in Wildwood after police believe a teenager may have lost control and crashed his car. It happened just before noon. Ridge Road was shut down for several hours while the scene was cleared. Police believe speed and the country roads, the winding roads, were probably a factor in the crash. No word yet on any injuries. We're getting a behind-the-scenes look at a brand new hospital in the Metro East. St. Elizabeth's showed off their new $300 million facility this morning. It's located on Greenmount Road, just north of Interstate 64. Ground was broken in June of 2015. The hospital is not considered a level one trauma center, but officials say it is equipped with some cutting-edge medical technology.
The other piece is the technology. I didn't think I would see robots in my lifetime, but we have robotic surgery in several areas and then also very high-tech cardiac cath labs so that patients can have an emergent procedure, whether it be closed or open.
Officials hope the 144-bed facility will help more Southern Illinois patients, many of which are usually transferred to St. Louis. Ahead at 5, hurricane aftermath. Businesses clean up after Hurricane Nate makes landfall along the Gulf Coast as a Category 1 storm. And a new study shows a sharp drop in youth football players, and coaches say it's due to growing health concerns.
Ahead for us, the new war of words between the president and a leading senator from his own party. Plus how some of those wounded in the Las Vegas mass shooting are now struggling to pay for their treatment. Also, a close-up look at this country's opioid crisis with some of the emergency responders trying to save lives. And a celebrity chef serving up more than 100,000 meals in Puerto Rico to people still struggling after Hurricane Maria. All ahead on Nightly News.
St. Louis County Police believe a man one of their officers shot on October 1st wanted the officer to kill him. Police were called to a home in Afton, Missouri 1 week ago today. They say 38-year-old Joshua Lanfleecy opened the front door holding a gun and a sword. He then released a dog and came out holding the weapons. Police say they asked him to drop the weapons, but he didn't. Officers shot the suspect, and then he later died from his injuries. Police said today they found a suicide note inside the home. Police also say a third-party witness confirmed their story. Heavy flooding is the concern for some in Biloxi, Mississippi, after Hurricane Nate made landfall as a Category 1 storm. This video was taken in the Golden Nugget Hotel, a popular tourist destination there. Water washed through much of the first floor this morning. Nate is now considered a tropical depression and is moving into the Tennessee Valley. For the first time in 15 years, an American has won the annual Chicago Marathon. A man named Galen Rupp crossed the finish line in just over 2 hours and 9 minutes. More than 40,000 runners took part, and more than a million spectators lined the route. This year was the event's 40th year. Vice President Mike Pence walked out of an NFL game today because athletes on the field were protesting. It happened at today's 49ers-Colts game. Players on the sideline directly in front of Pence's seat knelt for the national anthem. Pence left the game shortly after pregame and took to Twitter to explain. He said he would not, quote, dignify any event that disrespects our soldiers, our flag, or our national anthem. He also said everyone is entitled to their own opinions, but claimed standing for the anthem was not too much to ask. Many players in the NFL have held similar protests in recent weeks. The display was originally in protest of police brutality. Damage control following the disastrous data breach from Equifax. In tonight's Consumer Report, how to lock down your money and protect your credit. Solar-powered race cars. A high-tech race takes off to cross a continent using only solar power.
And plenty of solar energy across our region today. It's been a beautiful afternoon, lots of sunshine, the high temperature close to 80 degrees. We're going to talk about some changes coming up with the forecast and chances for storms. Stay tuned.
Well, get ready to fall in love. It's hard not to once you meet a four-year-old girl from Godfrey, Illinois, who just loves ice cream.
What's your favorite kind of ice cream?
My favorite kind of ice cream is chocolate.
Chocolate? You like chocolate? Do you like vanilla?
Yes.
Yes. Do you like strawberry?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, Kaylee has been spending more time at the hospital than the ice cream shop. Tonight on our late news, how despite a devastating diagnosis, she brightens the day for everyone around her. It's my Making a Difference report after football. Experts say all victims of the Equifax data breach should have a security freeze on their credit by now, but there are other things you can do to put a wall around your money. Hillary Palatnick explains in tonight's Consumer Report.
After the Equifax breach, your finances could be vulnerable for years. Fortunately, Consumer Reports says you can take additional steps right now to help lock down your money. First, set up and activate two-factor authentication on any of your financial accounts that offer it, including mobile banking, credit cards, and a home equity line of credit.
It's an important extra layer of protection. So it's your password plus a code that's texted to your cell phone that only you have, or it's your password plus, say, a scan of your fingerprint.
Next, secure your mutual funds. Investment firms aren't required to restore assets stolen by hackers. Two big investment firms, Fidelity and Vanguard, do have reimbursement policies in online hacking cases. But you should check the coverage details with your own investment manager.
If your investment company doesn't explicitly say that it reimburses stolen funds, consider moving your money elsewhere.
Finally, don't forget the simple move of placing a fraud alert with the three major credit bureaus. It's free and provides a first step warning to potential lenders not to open accounts in your name without taking extra steps to verify it's actually you applying for the credit. This is Hillary Palatnick.
Experts recommend getting a copy of your credit report as often as possible. Even things like keeping your computer's security updated can help protect you as well. Fear of lasting head injuries is keeping some students out of youth football, according to a recent study. The Chicago Sun-Times study focused on schools in the suburbs of Chicago. Overall, 20% fewer students are trying out for football compared to 10 years ago. In some schools, that number is 40%. Parents and coaches say more variety in sports programs may be a factor, but the largest drop came in the year after the release of the movie Concussion, which focused on head injuries. A world-class race of solar cars is underway. 50 cars from 26 countries are racing just under 2,000 miles across Australia. The race began this morning, and drivers have 1 week to finish the journey. They are allowed a small battery backup, but they still have to use a car that runs completely on solar power. Believe it or not, this is the race's 30th year. Hundreds of people spent the weekend celebrating a long-standing model train tradition. The St. Louis area's 27th annual model train show was held at the Kirkwood Community Center. There were kids' toys and professional-grade models, even one made entirely out of Legos. The event also serves as a way for collectors to get their hands on some of the most rare train sets. The event wrapped up at 4. Also on display this weekend, fine art from across the country. The historic Shaw Art Fair was held today and yesterday. 135 artists traveled to St. Louis to show off some of their stuff. Some relaxing music and food made it seem pretty relaxing to many, but a strict judging panel was sure to keep all those artists on their toes. This was the event's 25th year. And Craig, it was a beautiful day for an art fair outside.
Fantastic. You know, I got up on the weather deck, just wanted to take a few pictures and look, and it is just gorgeous. I mean, this is one of those evenings where you just want to get out and soak it up.
For sure.
When you're not working as we are right now. But I'll tell you what, other parts of the country, not so lucky. We were talking about Nate. I've got some good news in that Nate is weakening, but I wanted to show you a video from the landfall early this morning and around Biloxi. They were dealing with a storm surge of about 4 to 5 feet. So they did have some surge associated with Nate. Nate has weakened considerably. Maximum winds around 80 to 85 miles per hour. It was a category one at landfall, and it has since weakened. So let's show you where it is right now. Just a rainmaker, and it's bringing rain across much of the Tennessee River Valley and pushing towards the Virginias into some of the western parts of North Carolina. You'll notice we're on the back edge of this. We were seeing just a little bit of cloud cover from the westernmost side of Nate, but that's rolling away and our sky is going to become mainly clear. So there's the forecast. Again, it's going to become just a remnant low overnight, and by tomorrow morning, really just a rainmaker for this part of the country. For our area, we're looking at a beautiful evening. I mentioned that. Let's take a look at the forecast. Generally speaking, we're looking at mainly clear skies. So if you've got plans tonight, maybe you want to go out and take a walk after dinner, or just spend some time outside. This is your evening to do it, mainly clear. I do want to let you know, though, late tonight and early tomorrow morning, I think we're going to see some fog developing, and it may be locally dense. So it's really important that you get up early tomorrow morning, check in with Chester Lampkin and Anthony Slaughter. They'll be watching those roads tomorrow morning if we do have fog issues. You can see how things have cleared out pretty nicely. We'll pick up our future cast. While tomorrow should be dry, there's just a slight chance of a stray sprinkle. I don't think we see much, but we'll be watching for that fog early in the morning, and just a very low risk, about a 10% chance for an isolated sprinkle later in the day. Watch what happens overnight and into early Tuesday. That's where we'll start to see more moisture streaming in. And I think Tuesday morning, that's when we're going to see the chances, not only for scattered showers, but a few isolated storms in the mix as well. A few of these storms could pack a little bit of a punch with some gusty winds, so we'll be watching for that. Looking ahead, though, Tuesday afternoon and evening, kind of off and on, I think additional chances for showers or a few stray storms later Tuesday, and then the rest of the week looks pretty good for us, and we still actually could use a little bit of rain, so that's not a bad thing. Temperatures right now, upper 70s to low 80s. As we head into the evening, skies are going to remain mostly sunny or mainly clear once that sun goes down. You can see currently we're at 79 with plenty of sunshine at Lambert. South winds at 5 miles per hour. Overnight, 63. Again, watch for some of that fog late tonight. Tomorrow's high back up around 86, so it's another warm one, but we will see the changes coming up Tuesday with highs near 76, scattered showers and storms possible. After that, we're going to see the temperatures back close to normal on Wednesday. Skies will clear during the day on Wednesday, and then look at the rest of the week. More sunshine as we finish out Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Really looking good. Temperatures, though, warming back up. It's like we're waiting for fall to really arrive, Mike. Obviously, temperatures getting warm again next weekend. Chances for a few isolated showers by Sunday.
All right, great. Okay. Thanks. We'll be right back with sports.
The Five on Your Side Sports Desk is sponsored by Mattress Direct.
Granted, it's only been two games, but wow, the Blues have been impressive, and especially when it comes to the defensemen. If you look back on the week as a whole, the Blues have scored a total of 9 goals, and 5 of those goals have come from the D-men. We saw Alex Petrangelo and Colton Parayko light the lamp in the season opener against the two-time defending Stanley Cup champions. Then last night in the home opener, it was Carl Gunnarsson who got the party started. Not even a minute later, or minute and a half later, Joel Edmondson found the back of the net, and just like that, the Blues jumped out to an early 2-0 lead in the first period. That has to be a first in the franchise's history, right? Where 4 different defensemen have scored in a season's first 2 games. It is, and it's the style of play that head coach Mike Yeo wants to see.
A lot of credit needs to go to the defensemen as far as how they jumped up and got involved in the play, and we want that, but that doesn't happen if your forwards don't have the good wall play. And on the flip side of that is we want to defend as 5-man units as well too. The league has trended this way a lot more, where it's not just forwards, defensemen, wingers and centermen. If you want to play a faster game and be tougher to play against, then different guys have to be a little bit more available and have the ability to play different positions and different roles.
Well, speaking of the Blues defensemen, Captain Alex Petrangelo is one of the best of the current crop in the entire National Hockey League. He takes a lot of pride in wearing that C on his chest. And as he enters his second year as the Blues' valiant leader, this is one of the biggest things he's learned from last year that he hopes will help the Blues this year.
I think halfway through the year, I really realized that I had to lean on other guys. And you know, being a captain doesn't mean you're supposed to do everything by yourself. I mean, it's an opportunity to lead guys, a big guy leading by example. And with the type of guys we have in our locker room, the camaraderie, the older guys, I just learned to lean on them. And certain things that they can, handle that I don't need to, and trust them to lead as well.
That's just a sneak peek of what's to come tonight after Sunday Night Football in our one-on-one interview. All right, postseason baseball is in full swing, and as you are well aware, we are not experiencing a Red October in St. Louis. So as management looks to the offseason that's ahead, what's the focus?
We're not trying to copy someone. We're unique. You know, we believe this organization has been on a very, very nice run over the last 17 years, and we want to continue that. And so I'm not using the phrase rebuild. We want to fix what we have, and we want to build upon it.
If you look at each of the five NL teams that made the playoffs this year, they have that one thing that the Cardinals did not, and that was that premium bat. So if they want to say they don't want to rebuild, just add talent, that is the inner area that they need to focus on.
They have work to do, for sure. All right, Audrey, thanks. And there you have it, five on your side at five. NBC Nightly News is next. We'll see you right back here after football.